My name is Edward Greenspan. This week's episode of The Scales of Justice is The House on the Hill, the dramatization of the murder of Edmonton golf pro Frank Wiley, whose body was never found. Coming up next on Stereo Theater, right after the news.
A huge fire forces the evacuation of a small town in British Columbia. I'm Chris Skeen with the CBC News. BC's largest uncontrolled forest fire has forced the evacuation of one town, and officials are becoming more and more concerned about a popular hot springs resort nearby. The evacuation order was given after brisk winds whipped a fire to almost three times its original size overnight. More than 1,000 residents of Canal Flats are leaving their homes, as are about 600 people who live along the north shore of Columbia Lake in southeastern British Columbia. Gary Godet has this report.
Ray Wormald of the Provincial Forest Service says the evacuation is being carried out by officers of the Provincial Emergency Program and the RCMP.
RCMP have set up roadblocks at both ends of Columbia Lake, with all forms of traffic prohibited in that region. Ministry officials report the evacuation was ordered mainly because of dense smoke in the area and concern for public health and general well-being. It's not that the flames are licking at people's front doors. That's a point that I should emphasize. And those who are being evacuated are being advised they may be away from their homes for up to a week.
Continuing hot, dry weather now has officials worried about the nearby resort town of Fairmont Hot Springs. Fairmont sits at the north end of Columbia Lake and is a magnet to tourists each summer. It has about the same year-round population as Canal Flats, and unless there's a major change in the weather, Fairmont Hot Springs will be the next community threatened by the 4,500-hectare blaze in southeastern British Columbia. Gary Godet, CBC News, Vancouver.
In Newfoundland, crews are battling at least 40 forest fires. Today, favorable winds kept flames from threatening Davis Inlet, a small community on the Labrador coast. Yesterday, the residents were preparing to leave. Near Goose Bay, a fire that began more than a week ago is still out of control. That fire isn't seen as a threat to the community, but it's keeping 140 firefighters backed by water bombers busy. American law officers have arrived in Calgary saying they'll seek the extradition of Charles Ng, who was arrested yesterday on a charge of shoplifting. He's wanted in San Francisco in connection with a series of sex torture and deaths. He's been the object of an international manhunt for more than a month. Ng is to appear in court in Calgary tomorrow to face charges arising out of his attempt to escape capture yesterday by shooting the store detective who had apprehended him. The detective was wounded in the hand. The FBI wants Ng back in California to continue the investigation into the deaths of 22 people. Normally, any charges laid in Canada have to be dealt with before the accused is extradited. There are contradicting reports on the outcome of the three-day OPEC meeting in Vienna. One says that it broke up without success, the other that agreement was reached. As Sue Masterman reports, both are right.
The OPEC meeting was a failure because it never got off the ground. For 3 days, the 13 ministers were involved in what they call a consultative meeting, which usually leads to a general or an extraordinary meeting. A consultative meeting can take no binding decisions, so that the 13 member countries are not bound to respect decisions taken here. The meeting proper will now, they hope, be held on July the 22nd in Geneva. It does appear, however, that the 3 days of discussions led somewhere. There is now a real threat that countries caught giving discounts below the OPEC fixed price could be expelled from the organization. This is a success for Saudi Arabia, whose powerful oil minister Sheikh Yamani has decided to get tough. Before the meeting, he threatened to knock the bottom out of the oil market if other countries did not stop busting price and quota agreements. But the measure of his success will not be seen until the meeting in Geneva. For CBC News, this is Sue Masterman in Vienna.
25 people were killed in the Pakistani city of Quetta yesterday when Shiite demonstrators opened fire on police. About 5,000 Shiite refugees planned to march into the center of Quetta to demand certain religious rights. The authorities banned the march, but when police tried to stop it, Shiite gunmen perched on rooftops opened fire with automatic rifles. 13 policemen and 12 demonstrators were killed in the gunfight, which lasted several hours. And that's the CBC News. The Metro Toronto weather forecast, a few clouds tonight, a low near 13 is expected overnight. Monday, partly cloudy with a chance of a shower and thunderstorm. A high Monday near 28. The chance of rain, 10% tonight, 20% on Monday. The outlook for Tuesday, chance of a shower and thunderstorm. It's 24 degrees. The relative humidity is 57%. The wind is from the west-northwest at 19 kilometers per hour, and the barometer is steady. It's 7:05. This is CBC Stereo, serving Toronto and Peterborough.
Stereo Theater presents The Scales of Justice.
Hey, Charlie, I'm glad you're back. They've been tearing the shop apart in here.
I'll bet. There's still a mob lined up at the first tee.
Oh, yeah. Holiday doesn't even start till tomorrow. Every hacker in town sneaking off work early to get here. So, how'd it go?
No problems. I got the set of clubs you wanted. Here, two woods, 8 irons, and a putter.
Yeah, look fine. How much did it cost you?
Well, you said no more than 225, right?
Yeah.
I was going to get Spalding Dynaflights, but Marshall Wells was out of stock. So I picked up this set of professional models instead. Less than 200 bucks.
Good boy. Slip a couple of head covers and stick them all in that red and white bag.
Sure. Where do you want them put?
Toss them in the back seat of my car. I got to deliver them tonight, damn it. Perfect timing. My mom and sister just flew in from Vancouver to spend Easter. I didn't even have time to meet them. Paris had to pick them up at the airport with the kids.
So what's the big rush with the clubs? Who are they for?
No idea. Guy called this morning. Said he just moved here from Vancouver. Wants a new set of ladies' right-handers as a present for his wife. But 2 1/4 tops.
Mm.
Something about they're going away for a long weekend. He wants to surprise her. Says they just bought a house up on the hill. I gotta take him up there tonight.
Jeez. Some people. Your life's just not your own.
It was 4 p.m. on Thursday, April the 19th, 1962. When Frank Wiley, the popular golf pro at Edmonton's Riverside Golf Course, had this casual conversation with his young assistant, Charles Cairns. That evening, Wiley worked in his pro shop till 7:45. He drove home, had dinner, spent an hour with his mother and sister, two sons and his wife, Paris. Then slipping into an overcoat, he said he had to deliver a set of clubs. Shortly after 9 p.m., he drove off in his 1960 white Oldsmobile. His family never saw him again. His body was never found. Yet within 2 weeks of his disappearance, two men, Raymond Workman and William Huckaluck, were charged with Frank Wiley's murder. My name is Edward Greenspan, and the story you are about to hear is reconstructed from the transcripts and judgments of the Supreme Court of Alberta and the Supreme Court of Canada.
The Scales of Justice, a series recreating real events in Canadian crime, with commentary by the Toronto lawyer Edward L. Greenspan, QC. In this episode, you will hear Michael Hogan as Raymond Workman in the true story of The House on the Hill, written by Paul King and produced by George Jonas.
On Good Friday, the morning after Frank Wiley's disappearance, the city of Edmonton was quiet except for families heading to church. No one in Wiley's own family reported him missing until late that night, nearly 27 hours after he'd left home. But other citizens in the city had noticed unusual situations and were phoning the police. At 5 p.m. that day, the duty officer at the Southside Police Station got a call from a John Kamsky at 9347 73rd Avenue.
Duty officer.
Hello. I just want to report a strange car in front of my house. It's been sitting there all day with its windshield wiper sticking up. I think maybe it's been stolen or abandoned.
What kind of car is it, sir?
Looks like an Oldsmobile. Fairly new, white with brown top. License starts HC something. You want me to check?
Well, sir, we've had no report of any stolen car by that description.
So, okay, just thought you should know.
Thank you, sir. We'll make a note of it.
Then, 30 minutes later, at 5:30 p.m., the police received another call from a house builder named Edmund Saperko, who was constructing a new split-level home on a hillside at 9904 73rd Street. Saperko sounded extremely agitated.
I think you should send some policemen to my place. I came over to look at my house this morning, just to check, you know, and there's blood all over. It's on the floors, it's on the walls. In basement, there's big puddle. I think somebody has been hurt bad or something.
Yeah?
The blood was not here yesterday when I closed up. I think...
When did you discover the blood, Mr. Superco?
Maybe 10 this morning, when I just came over to check.
Thank you, Mr. Superco. If you stay at the house, we'll send someone over soon.
Neither the parked car nor the bloodstains in the house on the hill were connected to each other or Frank Wiley until just before midnight when the constable on the complaint desk got a call from a Mrs. Paris Wiley to report her husband missing. She said he'd driven away from home at 9 p.m. on the previous day, and she described him as 48 years old, 5'10", 180 pounds. But the key piece of information was when she was asked for a description of the car.
Well, it's a 1960 Oldsmobile. A white Olds with a, you know, a tan top. And the license is, HC2844. No, HC2845. Oh, it's one of those. I just don't remember exactly.
A white 1960 Oldsmobile. License starting HC. The same as had been reported abandoned on his street by John Kamsky. It wasn't until the following day that the police connected both descriptions and checked the car. But by then, officers were already investigating the bloodstains in the unfinished house on the hill. Constable Theodore Tetzlaff had been the first on the scene. In court, he told Crown Attorney Shortreed,
Mr. Superco had the front door secured with a kind of scaffold. We took this down, went inside. I had a flashlight with me and looked around, noticed a large bloodstain on the living room floor. Then I saw another large stain in the kitchen doorway.
Did you notice anything about these stains?
Yes, they were partially covered with sawdust. Looked like it had been thrown over the stains and scraped. Then I went down into the basement.
Constable Tetzlaff testified that he also saw blood on the living room walls, on the stairways, on the back door handle, and another huge pool in the basement behind the furnace. It was half an inch deep, still not congealed, and had soaked through the floor from the living room above. After that initial investigation, Constable Tetzlaff and two other officers who had joined him set the scaffolding up against the front door and left the premises. But they had missed one crucial piece of evidence which the builder Superco had noticed earlier that morning, but forgot to point out. He described this later in court.
On the morning of the 20th, Mr. Superco, before you called the police, did you notice anything in the bedroom?
Yes, a piece of cloth on the floor. Maybe 14, 15 inches long, and it was wrapped in four or five places with scotch tape.
This cloth was what, sort of cylindrical?
Yes, it was right in a circle, right around.
This piece of cloth in a tubular shape might well have become vitally important, but the following day, Saturday, April the 21st, Superco returned to the new house on 73rd Avenue at 6 o'clock in the morning. Later, he told the court,
Had any of your employees been in your house that night after you left it?
No.
Did you notice anything different about the bloodstains that you saw the day before?
There was water on them.
Have you any idea where the water came from?
Well, the plasterer left barrels of water outside. That's the only place where water was at that place.
And did you notice anything different in the bedroom from the day before?
Well, I was looking for that piece of cloth, but I just couldn't see it no place.
Was it gone?
It was completely gone.
Obviously, some other person or persons had been in the house that night. But the police had still not connected the bloodstains with Wiley's disappearance. After all, he had only been reported missing the night before. On that same Saturday, as investigators combed the house, a constable was dispatched to 73rd Avenue, where John Kamsky had reported the abandoned white Oldsmobile 24 hours before. When he arrived, the car was unlocked, but the keys were missing. In the back seat, he noticed a red leather golf bag. Then, after finding the registration card with Frank Wiley's name and address, he phoned the Wiley residence. When Paris Wiley answered, he told her where the car was located. 30 minutes later, she arrived in a cab with her visiting sister-in-law, Rose Ellen Hall, and the white Oldsmobile, without its missing owner, was driven back to the Wiley residence. In court, Crown Attorney Shortreed was interested in learning what happened inside the house after the two women returned.
What happened that evening, Mrs. Hall, after you returned to your brother's?
Well, Paris phoned up Mr. Workman to come over, and he came around 9.
How long was he there?
I couldn't tell you. He was still there when I went to bed.
And on Sunday, the next day, did you leave town?
Yes. After lunch, Mr. Workman drove us to Clive, Alberta. My mother wanted to see these people. They were neighbors of hers in England.
I see. And who went with you on this trip?
My mother, the two boys, Paris, Wiley, myself, and Mr. Workman.
And what vehicle did you use?
My brother's Oldsmobile.
What time did Mr. Workman arrive at your brother's?
It was around lunchtime. We had something to eat, and then we... He went out to the garage to look at the car. He said he wanted to check it.
And after he checked it, what did he say?
He said the tire had a hole in it and another wheel had been changed and put on the front.
All right. Now, when you started on this trip, how was the car running?
Not very good. It seemed to lean on one side all the time. In fact, just after we started, Mr. Workman drove it into a garage to check it over. He went under himself and looked at it, and he said the frame was bent or something. And after that, we just drove on.
At this point, Frank Wiley had been missing from Thursday night to Sunday noon, more than 60 hours. As Raymond Workman drove the Wiley family south on that Easter Sunday, the Edmonton police were questioning various laborers who had been working on that house on April the 19th, just hours before Frank Wiley disappeared. One was Eric Hines, a house painter. That afternoon, he told the police he'd been painting the rear outside wall of the house with his partner, Ewald Chetkowski, when the back door opened around 2 p.m. and a man walked out.
Oh, hello. You come here to see me?
No, no, not particularly. Just drop by to see how the job's coming along.
I was going to phone you. I'm getting worried where my income taxes are.
Oh, hell, Eric, don't worry about that. I always file my returns for my clients on time. I'll be ready.
Okay, it's good. I was getting worried.
So how's everything going?
We're so-so. In the spring, you know, the business is always slow. That's why we're both on this job. This is my partner. He's Ewald.
Oh, how you doing?
Yeah, hello.
Well, looks like you're both pretty busy now.
Yeah, Superco's pushing this job down fast.
Yeah, so I hear. I guess you're working late hours in this one. Lots of overtime?
Well, yeah, but tonight we'll be quitting on time, I think. Easter weekend, you know.
So everyone knocks off early.
Yeah, tonight we go home maybe 4:30.
Well, have a good holiday, boys. And don't worry about the tax thing, Eric. It'll be ready. So, okay, I'll be seeing you. Nice to meet you, Evil.
Yeah, you too. Who is that guy?
An accountant. He's the guy I told you. He's doing my income tax for last year. He does all the books for Superco. Very smart. Name's Workman. Raymond Workman.
After questioning the painter, the police officer noted Workman's name. At the time, it simply appeared like a casual visit by a curious accountant. And Workman was an accountant. He did do Superco's books. But when the police questioned Edmund Superco, he said he was surprised to see Workman at the house. He later repeated it in court.
In the course of Mr. Workman's duties, did you require him to visit any of your houses under construction?
No, sir.
Was it part of his job to count material? Anything like that?
No, it wasn't.
Yet not only had Workman arrived at the house the day of Wiley's disappearance and asked the painters if they'd been working late, but a few weeks earlier, he'd been at the house with another man when Superco suddenly walked in. As Superco later told the court...
It was around supper time. I was just went back to check things out, and there they were, standing in the living room.
Was anyone else in the house?
No, no one else.
Well, what did Mr. Workman say when you came in?
Well, he said he's showing the house to his friend. He said, nice place, you know, stuff like that. We all stayed 5 or 10 minutes, maybe then left.
Did he introduce the other man?
Yes. The name was Huckalack.
Meanwhile, the Edmonton papers had learned of the missing golf pro. From then on, the case was splashed daily across the headlines. And because of the press publicity, as well as police inquiries, new witnesses suddenly started to appear. One key eyewitness was Jeanette Gillardot, who lived directly behind the house on the hill where the bloodstains had been found.
Just a second, officer, till I turn the darn TV down. Sorry about that. Now, what were you asking?
Where exactly were you on that evening, Mr. Lardo?
Oh, right here. I stayed home that night and I was watching TV. And during the commercials, about, quarter to ten, I went into the kitchen for a drink of water. Anyway, I just happened to look out the back window and saw two cars in the lot across the lane. I thought it was sort of funny that anyone would be out there at that hour.
What sort of cars were there, miss?
White. Both were white. One, I think, was a 1960 or 61 Olds. When I saw the cars, they were getting ready to leave.
Who did you see, miss?
Well, these two men. One man got into the Olds and started to drive off. But he didn't seem to know how to drive it because it started backing up in a hurry, real jerky-like. The other man started yelling at him and he stopped.
Well, where was the other man at this time?
Well, he was standing beside the other car. But then he went over and yelled at the bad driver, then went back to his own car and got in. They both took off at the same time, in one blazing hurry, I tell you.
Could you identify either of them?
No, sir, I couldn't. It was dark out, you know.
Jeanette Gilardo's evidence was important. Not only did she establish that two men were outside the bloodstained house within an hour of Wiley's disappearance and that one was a terrible driver, but she noticed the direction they headed off in. It was later determined that within minutes after the cars drove away, the Oldsmobile had an accident. At 10 p.m. that night, Stanley Gadowski was working at the Braemar Esso station, just three blocks away, when a man walked in from the street holding a tire. As Gadowski told the court,
I was standing at the pumps when I saw this man standing there with a tire.
Hey, son, you think you can fix this tire in a hurry? I just got a flat.
Well, we can fix it, mister, but not in a hurry. I'm busy as hell at the pumps tonight, and the boss says the pumps come first.
Well, okay, we're not far off. I'll be back to get it before midnight.
What happened then?
Well, then he left the tire and just walked off. Later, after 11, I looked at the tire and saw we couldn't fix it. So I tied on this tag saying, big brake and tire. I also stuck the order form with his name on it in the tire rim.
And what was the name you wrote?
R. Workham.
Workham.
Well, that's what it sounded like to me.
At midnight, Michael Sturby took over from Gadowski. 2 hours later, another customer, Ernest Stolliday, drove in. Stolliday wanted four new white wall tires mounted on his 1956 Cadillac, with another one placed in his trunk as a spare. Stolliday left the car at the station. But then, as Sturby later testified,
Sometime around 3:30 a.m., I remounted the four tires, but when I came to put the spare tire in the trunk, it was missing.
Did anyone else come into the station that morning?
Well, there was a man that picked this tire up that was turned out to be Mr. Stolliday's tire.
And who was that man?
Mr. Workman.
At what time did Mr. Workman arrive?
I'd say shortly after 3.
Did you discover the mistake when Mr. Stolliday returned?
Oh, before he returned. I went to put the tire in his car, and it wasn't there. So I checked the other tires in the garage and found one with Mr. Workman's name on it.
Yes?
So I phoned, four or five places at 3 in the morning, asking if Mr. Workman was there to say he'd taken the wrong tire. But except for making a lot of people mad, I had no luck. Trouble was, you see, the tire he took would only fit a Cadillac.
Soon after receiving this information, on Tuesday, April 24th, Detective John Evans went to the Riverside Golf Course.
Why did you go there, Detective?
I was called by an employee of the pro shop, which was operated by Frank Wiley.
And what occurred there?
I examined a set of golf clubs and a golf bag. I noticed on some of the irons in the putter what appeared to be blood specks. I seized them for evidence. At the same time, I also seized a 1960 Oldsmobile, which belonged to Frank Wiley.
Did you later examine the vehicle?
Yes, sir. On Wednesday, the following morning, I examined it on the hoist in the police garage.
And what did your examination disclose?
The tire and wheel on the left front of the car were a different size from the others on the vehicle. Tires for this car are 850-14. The tire on the left front was an 815. Also, the rim on that tire was dark, whereas the others were white.
The golf shop employee who called the police was Charles Cairns, the same young man who bought the clubs for Frank Wiley. But what were the car and clubs doing back at the pro shop? At the trial, Crown Attorney Shortreed asked Cairns.
Who presently operates the pro shop?
Mrs. Wiley.
When did Mrs. Wiley start operating the shop?
As soon as Frank disappeared.
So within a week after Wiley vanished, the police had recovered his car and clubs. But there was still no sign of the missing golf pro himself. Meanwhile, the local press and TV stations were asking anyone who'd seen anything unusual on the night of April the 19th to contact the police. As a result of this publicity, a farmer named Wilbert H. Crosswhite, living on the outskirts of Edmonton, came forward and later in court told the following story.
Well, I've been watching TV that night. I went to bed around 12:30, and then about, maybe a few minutes after 1, I heard the dogs kicking up a fuss outside.
All right, I'm coming. Yeah, what is it? Quiet there, dogs.
I'm terrible sorry to trouble you, sir. I know the time, but my friend here and I were turning our car around just down the road and got sort of stuck in the ditch. We get lost in these roads out here. I wondered if you could possibly give us a hand. I know how late it is.
Damn it, mister. I was sound asleep. I ain't even dressed yet.
Oh, I'd really appreciate it, sir. We have to get back to town. If you have a tractor or something, maybe you could...
You got me up anyway. Wait here till I get some clothes on.
And what happened then, Mr. Crosswhite?
Well, I piled these two fellas into my pickup, and they directed me to where their car was. The car was stuck in a field just inside the fence line. So I backed in across the ditch to the back of this other car and hooked a chain between the bumpers.
Do you know the make of the car?
No, it was pitch black out there. Besides, by then it was pouring down rain. No use, boys. The only way we'll budge her is if I back right up, give her the gas, and jerk her.
If you have to jerk it, jerk.
All right. When we get across the ditch here, break it. I don't want you smashing into me. Dang it, missy. I told you to break it when we cross the ditch. Now, look it. You broke your taillight.
Hey, it doesn't matter. Just as long as we're out of here. A little break in the taillight's nothing. Do you remember which tail light, Mr. Crosswhite?
Well, the same side as the driver, the left side on the rear.
Did you know the two men? Could you recognize them?
It was dark that night, raining.
Within hours of hearing Wilbert Crosswhite's story, the police launched a massive search of the field where the car had been stuck. When no body was found, police dogs and a helicopter were brought in to comb the entire area. The police were also checking the recent activities of Raymond Workman, the Wiley's family friend who had changed a tire on Wiley's Oldsmobile the last night the golf pro was seen. One person they questioned was Mr. Workman's landlady, Susan Taylor. And she told them that Workman had not spent the night at home before Good Friday. On the Friday, he hadn't returned until 2:30 p.m., and he'd promptly gone into the bathroom to wash mud off his shoes. Mrs. Taylor said Workman's explanation for being out all night was that he'd fallen asleep at the home of a friend, Paul Osborne. More and more, as the investigation tightened, circumstantial evidence pointed at Raymond Workman. But it was only circumstantial. Besides the lack of a body, one other puzzle still facing the police was the whereabouts of the second car that Jeanette Gillardot saw speeding away from behind her house on the night of April the 19th. It was this car, police suspected, that Wilbert Crosswhite had pulled from the ditch. Then the mystery was solved when detectives talked to the manager of Avis Rent-A-Car in Edmonton. The manager told them that Raymond Workman had rented a white 1962 Pontiac on the 14th of April and had returned it on the 24th with a broken left tail light. The news of the rented Pontiac had no sooner hit the headlines when the police received a call from Mr. Romeo Page, the superintendent of an apartment complex on 115th Street, who said he had important information about the car.
Mr. Page, you phoned to say...
You got to speak louder, son. I'm a bit deaf.
You knew something about a white Pontiac?
Oh, sure do. I seen them hosing it out the other day. White Pontiac 62, license starting with DU. I noticed these things, you know.
Well, what else did you notice, sir?
Well, I was sitting here reading in my living room last Monday, and I seen this strange sight. Here's this Pontiac in the yard, backed up to the garage. The car doors were all open, the back seat was taken out, and the trunk lid was up. And they'd run a hose out of the garage, and they're washing out the trunk. Hosing it. Water was running out all over the ground.
Who do you mean by they, sir?
Paul Osborne and this other man. They,
Paul Osborne?
Yeah. He rents a suite from me in that other building over there. Anyway, when I read about this Pontiac in the papers, I thought I'd better give you chaps a call.
Well, I'm glad you did, Mr. Page. Do you know who the man was with Mr. Osborne?
No. But I seen him around together. I noticed these things. He's also a pal of William Huckaluck's, who lives here, too.
William Huckaluck?
Yeah. Suite number 5, third floor.
Well, thank you, sir. You've been a big help.
How's my health?
No, you've been a big help, sir.
Ah.
Paul Osborne was the man workman had told his landlady he was with on the Thursday night when he never came home. The night Frank Wiley disappeared. It was also the second time police had heard of William Huckaluck. Builder Edmund Sapirko had told them that Huckaluck had visited his new house with Raymond Workman. The three men were obviously connected. But then on April 25th, just 2 days after Romeo Page saw the car trunk being hosed, a bizarre event occurred. Raymond Workman, the man the police had been circling, suddenly walked into police headquarters at 5:30 p.m. and asked to see Inspector Ernest Roberts. Roberts took Workman into a private office along with Detective William Laverty, who was heading the investigation. Later, Laverty told the court.
Did Workman say why he was there, Detective?
He said he'd heard we were looking for him.
And what did you discuss?
Well, after a few minutes of casual conversation, I asked Mr. Workman where he'd been over the weekend of the 21st, 22nd of April. He told me he'd hitchhiked to Calgary on the 21st. He said he frequently hitchhiked from place to place, and then he told me that on Sunday, April 22nd, he'd gone to Clive, Alberta, with the Wiley family. That was about the extent of the conversation, sir. Mr. Workman left the station within a minute or two after that.
And at any time during that conversation, was there any mention of Frank Wiley?
No, sir, there wasn't.
Thank you, Detective. Will you answer my learned friend?
Detective Laverty, did you in fact want to see Mr. Workman?
Not particularly, sir, at that time.
Well, then why didn't you dismiss him instantly?
Well, I knew he had been a friend of the Wiley family, and I felt the time would possibly come up when I'd have to speak to him about Mr. Wiley's disappearance. This was an opportunity for me to size him up.
The police were not finished checking Workman's background. One person they questioned, who later proved to be a major witness, was Mrs. Irene Plyuk, assistant manager of the Skona Agency Limited, who had once not only been Workman's employer, but his landlady.
Will this take long, officer? You've come on a hectic day.
No, not long, ma'am. I just want to ask a few questions about a Raymond Workman.
Ray? Oh, you better come in. Shut the door behind you.
How long have you known him, Mrs. Plyuk?
Sit down. I'll give this to you fast. Well, whatever I know. I've known Ray, 11 years. He used to date my sister. He worked for me, for my husband and me, from the fall of 1960 to the 14th of October, 1961, as our accountant.
He lived in your home?
Of course. Home was his. He was a member of the family. He had his own bedroom in the basement.
Did you, while he was there, ever meet a Mrs. Paris Wiley?
Oh, God. Now I know why you're here. I've seen this in the paper. Did he... Is Ray...
No, I have no idea, ma'am. We're just checking a few leads.
Yeah, I knew Paris Wiley. Very well, I'm going to give this to you in sequence, okay?
Please do.
Okay, now, Ray first brought her to our house in the middle of June last year. After that, she came 2, maybe 3 times a week. She and Ray were dating. Her marriage was on the rocks, you know? You knew they planned to get married.
No, ma'am, I didn't.
Oh, yeah, sure. Last year, on my birthday, July the 1st, at the party, he announced that he and Paris were going to be married. Now, he said that he and Frank had a long talk and that Frank realized Paris wasn't happy and he was going to give Paris a divorce so she and Ray could get married in a year or two. Is this the sort of stuff you want?
Yes, ma'am, exactly.
Okay. Now, then, the end of September, Ray got a phone call about 10:30 at night. Now, there was a lot of commotion on the phone. Ray left the house, and around midnight, he returned with Paris and the two boys. Now, the kids are practically hysterical. They begged me to let them stay, so I let them stay overnight. But then, the following morning, Paris asked me...
Irene, listen, you've been an absolute doll about all this. I just don't know how to say thanks. The kids are so happy to be here. It's been perfect hell for them at home, you know. Mm-hmm. But I just wanted to ask... And I know it's a real big favor, Irene, but could we just stay on a little longer?
Well,
please. I'll take care of your house. I'll do all the washing, the cleaning, dishes, cook the meals, anything you ask. If only we could just stay.
For God's sakes, Paris, now where in the world do you all intend to sleep? I will not have you
and
Ray.
No. No, Ray says I can stay in his bedroom, and he'll sleep in the rumpus room with the boys. Oh, Irene, please. It'll be all right, I promise.
Did you let them stay?
Well, of course. The boys stayed about 3 weeks and went home. Paris stayed on. Then, one morning, we all overslept, and I rushed downstairs to wake Ray up. I turned on the lights, and Ray and Paris were in bed together.
Oh, my God.
Damn you two. Oh. Now, you promised me if Paris stayed that this wouldn't happen in my house.
Irene, listen to me.
No, please, no, Irene. I am finished listening to you two. Now, just get out, both of you. Oh. Just get your stuff. Just clear the hell out. I'm not...
Irene, listen. Just listen. Please, please. I'll go. I'll get out right now, but let Paris stay. She's got nowhere else to go. She can't go home, you know. Frank will kill her.
So, Ray got out, and I let Paris stay. But 3 weeks later, she went home. She hasn't been back.
At this stage, the police decided to have a more official talk with Raymond Workman. At 9:30 a.m. on May 3rd, 7 days after Workman had talked to Detective William Laverty and Inspector Ernest Roberts, the two senior officers drove to Workman's office at Dredger Construction Company, told him they were investigating Frank Wiley's disappearance, and asked if he'd join them again at the station. Workman readily obliged.
Mr. Workman, can you give us an account of your movements between Tuesday, April the 17th, and Monday, April the 23rd?
Tuesday. Oh, sure, that's the day... Yeah, I was downtown at noon and bumped into Frank Wiley.
You met Frank Wiley that Tuesday?
Yeah. The last time I saw him before, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Just outside the post office. He was all upset because he had a flat in his car. So I went over and changed that damn tire for him. Old Frank, you know, hit a hell of a golf ball, but the art of changing a tire was beyond his capabilities. Then, that afternoon, let me see. I played 18 holes at the municipal golf course. I came in 4 over par, in fact. I'm not a bad golfer myself, truth were known.
You played with Mr. Wiley?
No, alone. The tire thing, I told you, was the last time I saw him.
Workman told the officers that the following day he worked in the morning and golfed again in the afternoon. And while waiting to tee off, he met a man named Paul Osborne, who invited him to dinner the following night because he and his wife were strangers in town. On Thursday the 19th, the night Frank Wiley disappeared, Workman told the police he accepted the dinner invitation.
Well, I went, you know, because the guy seemed lonely. They don't know anyone else in Edmonton. It was just like a friendly gesture, you know. Paul's wife, Rose, cooked a fabulous meal, and then we sat down to watch the hockey game. And after that, I remember watching a bit of wagon train, and here's what's so bloody embarrassing. I fell sound asleep on the sofa.
This was the same story Workman had told his landlady. He said he'd awakened around midnight after the Osbornes had gone to bed, and then drove home in his rented Pontiac. The following day, Friday, he said he worked all day, then phoned Paris Wiley, who told him her husband was missing. He advised her to call the police. On Saturday, he said he'd hitchhiked to Calgary, visited friends in a hotel, and returned to Edmonton. The next day, Sunday, He said he drove Paris Wiley and her relatives to Clive, Alberta, as a friendly gesture, since Frank had taken off somewhere.
Now, Inspector Roberts, during this conversation at headquarters, how did Workman react?
He seemed to be enjoying himself. He seemed very confident. Periodically, he would stop, stare out the window, cross his leg, and suck his teeth. He seemed to be enjoying the game of wits, to put it frankly.
At noon, the detectives ended their questions to take Raymond Workman for lunch, when Workman talked mostly about golf. But back at the station that afternoon, the police questioning became more intense.
Mr. Workman, we've heard your account of the events from the 17th to the 23rd. We have reason to believe it isn't entirely true.
What? What the hell are you saying? You asked me, I told you. Well, what isn't true?
You said you returned home from Osborne's after midnight on the 19th. Your landlady tells us she came home at 2:30 the following afternoon.
She what?
She also says you muddied up her bathroom.
Hey, wait a minute. A Friday, yeah, you're right. It was in the morning. I slept till the morning. I didn't get home till 9.
Mrs. Taylor says it was 2:30 p.m.
No, definitely not. I was wrong about the midnight thing, but I was sure as hell home at 9.
Mr. Workman, we have reason to believe you know more about Frank Wiley's disappearance than you've indicated to us.
All right, damn it. If you're trying to nail me on that, I'm going to call my lawyer. I am not...
Sit down! We're not finished here yet. There's still a couple of questions.
You ask what you want. I'm not going to answer another damn thing till I talk to my lawyer.
And he didn't, which, of course, was his absolute legal right. He simply stared out the window and said nothing. But at 7 p.m. that same day, Raymond Workman was arrested for the murder of Frank Wiley. The arrest was not due to the accumulation of circumstantial evidence. The case was cracked open by the man who'd helped Workman hose the car trunk out, Paul Osborne. After skipping out of Hamilton, Ontario, 3 months before because of an outstanding warrant, he'd arrived in Edmonton and looked up his old pal, William Huckaluck. On the day Raymond Workman was being questioned by police, Paul Osborne was being interrogated in an adjoining room. Later in court, he had a story to tell.
Do you know Mr. Workman?
Yes, sir. Bill Huckaluck introduced us around the 1st of April. We met a few times.
What was the first conversation you had with him regarding this charge?
Evening of April 18th. It was in a parked car near my house. There was Workman and me, and Workman said he wanted Bill and me to work this guy over. He asked if we'd do it. I said I'd think it over. But I had no intention of doing any such thing.
Did he say how long he wanted you to think it over?
Well, Mr. Workman asked us to meet the next morning, way out at the Riviera Hotel. So Bill and I drove out there and met him about 10:30 in the lounge. So we ordered coffee, and then I went to the washroom.
And when you returned?
Well, Workman was still telling Bill he wanted this guy worked over. And then he came up with what he really wanted. He really wanted to have this guy killed.
And this, according to Osborne, is what happened.
Hey, hold it. Keep it down, will you? I got this all figured out. It's going to look like an accident, you see? Nobody's even going to know. Now, all I want you to do is to knock this guy out. You stick him in his car and drive him out onto some deserted country road. Then, you jack up the car and take a tire off. Then, you prop this guy beside the car like he's fixing a flat, you see?
What happens if he, wakes up?
Oh, Jesus, Bill, you whack him good enough to begin with. I don't even care if you kill him. Because then, when he's there beside the tire, you come along in another car and hit him, and it'll look like a hit and run.
What other car?
It doesn't matter what other car. Any car. My you drive. Just make sure you don't dent it up, and nobody will ever find out.
And where's this guy supposed to get knocked out?
Well, there's this new house that they're building that I know about, and nobody's in it at night. Now, I know how to get him up there. I've got it all figured out perfectly.
Hey, well, damn it. If you're going to discuss stuff like that, don't do it with me around. You're crazy. So I got up. Then we all left. Bill went off in Workman's car.
Did you hear from Workman again that day?
Yes, sir. I got a call about 1 p.m. He wanted to know if my decision was final. I told him it was, absolutely. And that was it.
Hmm. What did you do that evening?
Well, after dinner, my wife and me were just sitting around watching TV when Rose Huckluck came by sometime after 8 and asked if we'd seen Bill. We told her no, and she left. Then around 10, I got this call from Workman. Hello?
Hey, Paul, have you seen Bill anywhere? Is he there?
No, not since this morning.
That stupid bastard.
Hey, what the hell's the matter?
Oh, God, everything went haywire.
Hey, now you don't mean to tell me you went through with that thing.
Yeah, but now that stupid... Hey, listen, try to find him, will you? Phone around. I gotta get Bill fast, okay?
This was interesting. Why was Workman looking for William Huckaluck? How long that night had he been trying to find him? If the two men were not together throughout the entire evening of April 19th, was Huckaluck really involved? Might this phone call raise a doubt on that question? In court, Paul Osborne continued to give his account of the events of that night.
Then, around 11:30, 11:45, Rose Huckaluck phoned and asked us to come over. So my wife and me went. Their apartment's just behind ours.
And how long were you there?
All night. We were there all night. We talked with Mrs. Huckaluck until well after 3 a.m., and then Workman and Huckaluck came in.
Did you notice how Workman was dressed?
He had on a sweater. That's all I remember.
How did Huckaluck look?
Terrible. He looked like he'd seen a ghost. I took him into the bathroom to calm him down.
Christ, Bill. Come on, get a hold of yourself. What the hell happened out there anyway?
Oh, God, it was awful. This guy's eyes...
Come on, Bill.
His eyes were just sticking out of his head. Something... Oh, Jesus. Stuff's hanging out the back of his head. Hanging up the bag.
Okay. Okay, Bill. Forget it. Forget it. What? Come on. Your wife's going crazy. Come on. Get a hold of yourself, for Christ's sake.
Christ, Bill, pull yourself together. I mean, look at yourself. Oh, God, get those goddamn shoes off and get rid of them. They're muddy as hell.
Rose washed Bill's shoes off, and about an hour later, Bill and Workman left again.
Did either of them say why they were leaving?
Yes. Bill said there was a body in a shed somewhere. They had to go back and bury it.
Paul Osborne and his wife slept at Huckaluck's that night, then went home. But later that Easter weekend, Osborne said he talked to Huckaluck again. He told the court,
Bill told me about some bandages or tape flying off a wrench. He said when the person was hit, this tape flew off his wrench. Then he said they'd have to go back to this house and get it.
Did he say anything more about burying the body?
Oh, yes. He said they couldn't get this guy deep enough in the ground. The ground was too frozen.
Now, Mr. Osborne, did Workman come to your house on April 19th to have dinner and watch television?
No, sir, he didn't.
Did he fall asleep on a Chesterfield at your place on April 19th?
No, he did not.
This, of course, was in direct contradiction to what Workman told the police. It was also his only alibi for the night of April 19th. The Crown had just one final question for Osborne.
Did you ever have a conversation with William Huckaluck about a woman?
Well, he said he was scared about this woman talking to the police. He was afraid she'd break down and everybody wind up in jail. But Workman said he wasn't the least bit worried about her.
Paul Osborne, of course, was the Crown's key witness. Immediately after he told the police this story on May 3rd, 1962, Workman was arrested and a warrant was issued for the arrest of William Huckaluck. But when officers went to his apartment house, the superintendent, Romeo Page, said the Huckalucks had simply vanished. 2 days later, on May 5th, Huckaluck and his wife were arrested at gunpoint by Toronto detectives aboard the CNR Continental train, just outside Orillia, Ontario. The Huckalucks were just starting a steak dinner and had $1.85 between them. At the trial, Huckaluck's lawyer cross-examined Paul Osborne.
Mr. Osborne, your criminal record indicates that you used two names, Paul Osborne and Kyle Hadley. Why two names, sir?
Well, when I left the East, I wanted to start all over again. So I thought I'd do it with a new name.
You said Mr. Workman told you he'd like somebody worked over. Was there any money involved in this?
No, not that I recall.
You were going to do this for nothing?
I wasn't going to do it at all.
Yet you met with Workman and Huckluck in the hotel bar. And you tell us that when Workman suggested this man be knocked off, you suddenly wanted nothing more to do with it. Why?
Because I couldn't kill anybody, that's why.
Are you sure?
I know.
When you knew of these plans, why didn't you call the police?
Because I honestly never thought they'd do it.
Well, after you heard about the back of a head bashed in, why did you not call the police then?
I figured, well, because I hadn't called the police before, I was just as guilty as them. I was scared to call the police.
You were scared? Mr. Osborne, am I correct that you skipped bail in Hamilton because you did not wish to appear?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
Have you ever been in a mental institution?
Yes, sir, I have.
Dunn might have stopped here, leaving a serious doubt in the minds of the jury about Paul Osborne. But he chose to continue.
When?
Just a week ago.
What for?
Nervous collapse.
Osborne had indeed been recently hospitalized. Since learning of the murder, he'd been drinking steadily. But aspects of his story were corroborated by his wife and the bartender at the Riviera Hotel, who'd seen Osborne, Huckluck, and Workman there on the morning of April the 19th. One thing that had always been puzzling in this case was the inordinate amount of blood discovered in the house. Experts said it was far in excess of the usual amount most victims would spill even after serious injuries. But evidence was introduced that in 1943, while Wiley was in the Canadian Army, he'd been hospitalized for 8 days for excessive bleeding after a tooth had been pulled. At this point, the coroner, Dr. Max Cantor, gave an opinion.
It is extremely unusual for anyone to be confined for 8 days following a tooth extraction, unless he has some bleeding disease.
What would this suggest about Mr. Wiley, Doctor?
Would indicate he's what you would colloquially call a bleeder.
Doctor, the police laboratories have determined that approximately 3.5 liters of blood were found in the house. What is the minimum amount of blood that a 180-pound man must lose within, say, half an hour before he'd be dead?
An individual who loses that much blood in that short a time could not possibly survive.
It was one thing whoever killed Frank Wiley hadn't counted on. Frank Wiley was a bleeder. He had literally spurted blood on the floor, the walls, on his golf clubs. And the volume of blood was far too much to clean up quickly. There was one final witness to whose testimony the defense strenuously objected, and the jury was excused while the trial judge heard legal arguments. The proposed witness was a lawyer named Frank Pawlowski, and the defense claimed his evidence was a privileged conversation between a client and solicitor. The Crown argued it was not. Mr. Justice Milvain ruled the witness's statement admissible. Pawlowski then told the court that in February 1961, 14 months before Wiley's disappearance, he and Raymond Workman had both attended a construction company meeting. They had never met before. But after the meeting, as Pawlowski told the court, Workman approached him.
Mr. Pawlowski, you mind if I ask for a little advice?
What's on your mind?
Well, this friend of mine wants a divorce and also wants to know the chances of getting property from the spouse.
It all depends. Can your friend prove adultery of the spouse?
Oh, I don't think so, no.
Well, chances seem slim. Good night.
Good night, yeah.
The only way is for the other party to commence proceedings.
Phew, that's hardly likely.
Well, there's no other way of achieving this result.
Oh, yes, there is. We'll just have to kill him.
You're kidding, of course.
Hey, forget we talked, okay? Just forget I said anything at all.
The trial lasted 7 days, and the Crown called 46 witnesses. There was not a single witness called for the defense. Why? Not being privy to what the accused told their lawyers, it is very hard to say, and unfair, perhaps, to second-guess the two lawyers. In his closing address, Raymond Workman's counsel stressed one vital point.
The Crown must prove that Frank Wiley is dead and that he met his death at the hands of the accused. But it's our strong contention that the Crown failed to prove with any certainty that Frank Wiley or anyone died at 9904 73rd Street. If Mr. Osborne knew so much, why wasn't he able to direct the police to the alleged body?
It was now William Huckaluck's lawyer's turn to address the jury. This was his opportunity to point out that the circumstantial evidence tending to incriminate Workman did not necessarily involve Huckaluck as well. He could also emphasize that it was never shown that Huckaluck had any motive to commit murder. But Huckaluck's lawyer stood to deliver what may be the shortest jury address in a murder trial in Canadian legal history.
I'll be brief. In this case, you're not trying one person. You are trying two. And much of the evidence applies to one only. Do not be misled by the smokescreen which the Crown has seen fit to put up. Thank you.
After the judge's charge to the jury, they retired. The jury was out for only 2 hours and 28 minutes. The foreman was then asked,
"What is your verdict?"
"We find the accused guilty as charged."
On September 26, 1962, 5 months after Frank Wiley was last seen, Workman and Huckaluck were sentenced to hang. The following month, the decision was appealed to the Alberta Court of Appeal and was unanimously dismissed. On January 2, 1963, the case went to the Supreme Court of Canada. On February the 11th, the appeal was again dismissed, with two judges dissenting. The dissents were interesting and important. The two dissenting judges pointed out how critical it was to view the two accused separately. They agreed that the evidence against Workman was overwhelming, but were of the view that it was possible that Huckaluck had only been an accessory after the fact, helping to clean up the murder scene and then hide the body. Because the trial judge had not put this possibility to the jury, Mr. Justice Hall and Mr. Justice Ritchie would have given Huckaluck a new trial. The majority, however, did not see it that way. The sentences of Raymond Workman and William Huckaluck were commuted to life imprisonment. The body of Frank Wiley has never been found.
You have heard the true story of The House on the Hill, an episode in our series The Scales of Justice, recreating real events in Canadian crime. The script was by Paul King, and the commentary by the Toronto lawyer, Edward L. Greenspan, QC. In the cast, you have heard David Calderisi as Crown Attorney Shortreed, and Michael Hogan as Raymond Workman. Angelo Rosacos was heard as Bill Huckaluck and Booth Savage as Paul Osborne. You have also heard Harvey Atkin, Pixie Bigelow, David Bolt, Grant Buchanan, Michelle Clare, Alan Fawcett, Ron Hartman, Susan Hogan, Geza Kovac, William Lynn, James Morris, Frank Perry, Wayne Robson, Dixie Seidel, Howard Siegel, Paul Soles, Ray Stancer, and John Stocker. The apartment superintendent was played by Hugh Webster. Technical operations were by Derek Stubbs and sound effects by Stephanie McKenna. The production assistant was Nina Callahan, the music consultant Stephanie McKenna, and the casting director Ann Weldon Tate with the assistance of Catherine Kester. The associate producer is Guy Gavriel Kay. The Scales of Justice is produced in Toronto by George Jonas. This is Fred Napoli speaking. Next week, host Edward L. Greenspan looks at the Canadian test case for police entrapment. Listen to Snow Job by Guy Gavriel Kay on the Scales of Justice.
This is Harry Elton inviting you to join us for the second week of repeat concerts on Mostly Music from Western Canada. We begin on Monday in Winnipeg, Tuesday in Calgary, Wednesday in Edmonton, Thursday from Studio One in Vancouver, and on Friday from the Orpheum in Vancouver. A full week from Western Canada. Join us at 11:32 in Newfoundland.
Crews battle forest fires in British Columbia and Newfoundland. I'm Chris Skeen with the CBC News. Forest fires are causing concern on both sides of the country. In southeastern British Columbia, officials have ordered the evacuation of the small town of Canal Flats on the Columbia River. The largest of more than 500 fires in the province is burning out of control in that area. About 600 people living along the shore of Columbia Lake have also left. Officials are now worried about the nearby resort town of Fairmont Hot Springs. And in Newfoundland, fire crews are battling 40 fires. There are two major fires burning, one near Davis Inlet and the other near Goose Bay. Neither are threatening the communities. Meanwhile, the fires continue in the western United States. In Southern California, crews are still fighting two of the biggest fires that have consumed more than 52,000 hectares. Lightning started even more blazes over the weekend. Three people have been killed in the fires that started 10 days ago, and more than 130 homes have been left in ruins. The Prime Minister has wound up 3 days of meetings with his senior cabinet ministers in his hometown of Baie-Comeau. They discussed the legislative agenda for the next few months, and it appears the question of trade will be a top priority. More from Jeanette Mathey.
The Prime Minister calls the question of Canada's trading position a matter of great preoccupation. He says if Canada could recapture the markets it had in 1968, it would mean 500,000 more jobs. Mr. Mulroney won't use the term free trade, but he says the government is determined to enhance Canada's trading position. He says it won't be easy.
To do it in conformity with the need for liberalization around the world, in conformity with our obligations to GATT, energy agreements, and so on. It's a federal-provincial relations. It's a complicated matter, but we work on it constantly, and we hope to have some initiatives at the earliest possible moment.
Following a meeting in Baie-Comeau, Mr. Mulroney and his three children paid a visit to Cujuac in the northern part of his riding. It's his first visit to the area as Prime Minister. Mr. Mulroney promised to work to provide jobs for the region and generally improve living conditions. Jeanette Mathey, CBC News, Cujuac.
Prime Minister Gandhi told a news conference in New Delhi today that he hopes Canada will take tougher action in future to protect airline passengers. Mr. Gandhi says Canadian officials were not stern enough when clearing Air India Flight 182 for departure 2 weeks ago. The plane crashed off the Irish coast with the loss of 329 passengers and crew. In Baie-Comeau, Prime Minister Mulroney said he would not comment until he has read Mr. Gandhi's actual statements. The oil ministers of the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries have wound up an informal meeting in Vienna with an agreement to meet again on July the 22nd in Geneva. The meeting was called in an effort to find a way to maintain prices in the face of a decline in world demand for oil and an increase in production. The oil minister of Saudi Arabia told reporters after the meeting that agreement had been reached to end price discounting. However, the oil minister of Indonesia said the ministers had not agreed on any specific course of action. But he said they had reached a consensus to end all cheating on agreed OPEC prices. The current OPEC price for crude is $28 U.S. a barrel, but most sales are discounted by as much as $2 a barrel. The American Secretary of State says Vietnam has promised to return the remains of 26 U.S. servicemen missing since the Vietnam War. Mr. Schultz told a news conference in Hong Kong today that the handover will take place in about 6 weeks. Since the end of the war, Vietnam has returned the bodies of 99 American servicemen. However, more than 2,400 Americans are still listed as missing in action in Vietnam. Curtis Strange of Virginia has won the Canadian Open Golf Championship at Glen Abbey in Oakville, just west of Toronto. The 30-year-old says the Canadian National Championship is probably the biggest win of his life. He takes home $117,000 after finishing the four-day event with a score of 9 under par 279. That's just one stroke off from last year's record set by Greg Norman, who along with Jack the Golden Bear Nicklaus tied for second place, two strokes back from Strange. Top Canadians Dick Zokol of Vancouver and Dan Halderson of Brandon, Manitoba finished on an even par 288. And that's the CBC News. The Metro Toronto weather forecast, a few clouds tonight, a low near 13 is expected overnight. Monday partly cloudy with a chance of a shower and thunderstorm. The high Monday near 28, the chance of rain 10% tonight, 20% on Monday. The outlook for Tuesday, chance of a shower and thunderstorm. It's 24 degrees, the relative humidity is 50%, and the barometer's steady. The time is 8:05.
This is CBC Stereo, Toronto 94.1, Peterborough 103.9.